Good afternoon, everyone. How are you all doing? Well, this is a wonderful turnout. I'm so grateful to see so many people, so many familiar faces, a lot of new faces for our final What Matters to Me and Why of the semester. We had an extraordinary semester, and I hope you'll join us next year as we continue our What Matters to Me and Why series, the first Wednesday of every month. How many DPS folks do we have here today? Do we have anyone from DPS? Not a whole lot. Wow. So it's just all sorts of other folks. So listen, really grateful, excited to introduce you to our special guest speaker today. But I wanted to say a few words beforehand. I guess, you know, we're coming to the point of the year where there's not a whole lot of programs and events coming up. But I do want to invite all graduating students and their family to our baccalaureate ceremony. It's going to be on May 11th this year. It's Thursday at 5 p.m. at Bovard. Doors open at 4:30. This year, our baccalaureate speaker is Deepak Chopra. I'm very excited about that. I've been asking him for 9 years. I finally got him. So please attend if you can. And that's followed by baccalaureate dinner, which is the biggest dinner USC hosts during the year. It's hosted by the Division of Student Affairs, and it's a wonderful way for you to have dinner on the eve of commencement with your family and friends. You can buy tickets online. It's a very elegant three-course white linen kind of affair with live music. It's right here on campus. So if possible, I encourage you to go to the baccalaureate ceremony and then stick around for the baccalaureate dinner. If you're interested in the dinner, please check it out in RSVP soon, because tickets are going fast and we're going to be at capacity soon. So I'm really grateful to end this year's What Matters to Me and Why with my dear friend and colleague, Chief John Thomas of DPS. We have someone who will introduce him, but I just want to say a few words about John, because I know him very well. I admire him so much. I first met John because we both love Bob Marley, believe it or not. And I knew he loved Bob, but I didn't realize how much he loved Bob. And I wrote a book on Bob. I wrote my dissertation on Bob, and yet he still knows way more about Bob than I do. He even knew that Bob Marley once recorded under the name Bobby Martell. That's something I never knew. So I've learned a lot from him. And what I want to do something special for him today. So I invited the world's foremost authority, expert, and scholar on Marley to be with us today. He oversees the largest reggae archive in the world, the largest Marley archive in the world. His new book, An Oral History of Bob Marley, is going to drop this summer. And he came here with his wife. So I'm really just want to take some time to welcome and introduce Roger Steffens and Mary Steffens. Thank you so much for being here. It means a lot to me. It means a lot to John. It means a lot to all the reggae fans. So if you love Bob like we do, please talk to Roger afterwards. So as you know, one of the things that makes this series so unique, even though it's on many campuses around the country, is that here at USC, students choose the speakers, students nominate the speakers, students introduce the speakers. And they're usually students who have been mentored by the speakers. And today I'm really grateful to introduce you to our student who will introduce our speaker, Ryan Lopez. Ryan is graduating this year with a degree in chemistry. He's part of the DPS Youth Cadet Corps. And so in many ways, John has been his mentor really from day one here, even before he got here. It's been a great joy to see Ryan grow over the years as an undergraduate, and I know he's going to do great things in his graduate career as well. I'm very grateful to him for being here today. Please join me in welcoming Ryan Lopez.
Good afternoon, everyone. So my name is Ryan Lopez, and on behalf of the USC Office of Religious Life, I'd like to welcome you all to the final What Matters to Me and Why lecture series. This afternoon, it's my distinct honor and pleasure to introduce to you all Chief John Thomas, Executive Director in Chief of our USC Department of Public Safety. As a native Angeleno, Chief Thomas is a proud product of South Los Angeles, having graduated from Crenshaw High School before pursuing his bachelor's degree in political science at the University of California, Los Angeles. Don't worry, he's a graduate of USC also. Immediately after graduating from UCLA, Chief Thomas decided to pursue a career in law enforcement, joining the Los Angeles Police Department and graduating with Academy Class 1184. Throughout his 21-year career with the LAPD, Chief Thomas has worked basically every single assignment in the department, from patrol to narcotics, has worked almost every corner of the city, and has worked in some of Los Angeles' most famous and infamous events, including the visit by Pope John Paul II in 1987, the riots of 1992, and the Northridge earthquake of 1994. In addition to the work with the LAPD, Chief John Thomas is a graduate of the distinguished and prestigious FBI National Academy and a graduate of the West Point Leadership Academy. Now, in 2006, the university was honored to have such a law enforcement professional join our Department of Public Safety as captain before ascending to the rank of chief in 2013. Now, his resume is pretty impressive, but if one would have told an 11-year-old John Thomas that he would one day lead the nation's premier campus law enforcement, he would have probably been surprised that he would have anything positive to do with law enforcement. Like many residents of South LA, Little John's first encounter with law enforcement was not necessarily the most positive one. A very different pre-Rodney King LAPD had stopped 11-year-old John for simply jaywalking across the street in Watts. Now, this encounter with the LAPD, one that for many would have led to the beginning of a criminal record, taught 11-year-old John a valuable lesson: the importance of relationships with the community, as well as providing communities with the opportunity to be uplifted. Chief John Thomas credits growing up in the shadows of USC and seeing it as a resource in the community for why he was able to attain a higher education despite the adversity that he faced growing up. Chief Thomas has never forgotten his encounters with LAPD and has always kept them in the back of his mind when encountering a member of the community throughout his law enforcement career. Chief Thomas is a strong believer in the power of law enforcement community relations, and that together, by working as allies rather than as adversaries, these two entities can improve the standard of living for our communities. I know this personally. Upon arriving here at DPS, then Captain Thomas presided over the department's signature youth program, the Cadet Program, a priority of his, which allowed 13 to 20-year-olds from South LA to not only be exposed to law enforcement and have a positive interaction with law enforcement, but to expose them to a university setting. In 2012, I joined the DPS Cadet Program as a sophomore in high school. Honestly, I had no plans after high school. I probably thought I'd work, I might go to community college, or I might join the military. But thanks to Chief Thomas's mentorship and investment in our cadet program for our communities, I'm now 1 year away from being the first in my family to graduate from college with my BS in chemistry with an emphasis in chemical nanoscience. I'm so proud to be a product of the work that this man, who I'm proud to call my friend, has put forth toward the community throughout his entire life and career. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce you all to the chief of our Department of Public Safety, John Thomas.
As Ryan was giving me that very generous introduction, I was kind of wondering who he was talking about. But it's a pleasure to be here. I got a little nervous, some butterflies, but I really want to share with you and speak from my heart and talk about the things that are important to me. So don't be surprised if it's not a lot about law enforcement other than being in the context of where I think that profession needs to go. But I would be amiss to not introduce some very important people to me that I'm just grateful that they would even show up. And as you heard, one of my heroes is here, and he's right dead center. I got to look at him, and I used to listen to him on the radio for many years. Roger Steffens. Roger Steffens is by far the preeminent source for information regarding reggae, and of course, mine and Varun's hero, Bob Marley. So let me go through a couple of these introductions because they are so important to me. First is a legend in the city of LA. This man was instrumental in probably stopping the 1992 riots or civil unrest in South LA, probably more so than any of us in law enforcement or any elected official. He oversaw one of the preeminent African-American churches in the nation. He now oversees an important entity here at USC, the Center for community engagement, but I knew him when I was on LAPD as one of the individuals that helped save the city from burning completely down to the ground. And please, I'm very honored that he's here. The Reverend Cecil Chip Murray, First AME Church. A couple of other dear friends here that I have to introduce. My boss, he's sitting right there on the corner, so if I mess up, he'll give me the hook. Dave Wright, he supports us at DPS in our mission beyond anything I could have ever hoped for in my career. Dave Wright is here. Another very dear friend of mine who many of you don't know it. I've been here at USC for now 11, going on my 11 years, but DPS or any of the services here at USC would not be efficient without her assistance. We have worked on some of the most horrendous incidents to impact USC over the last 10 years. Very different. I always tease her and I tell her she's the unofficial DPS member, and we call her officer or commander or sometimes chief. But Dr. Lynette Merriman from Student Affairs, right there in the front row. We also commiserate often on carpool trips. We both live in Long Beach, so we cry on each other's shoulders quite often. Billy Villa, he's back in the back. Raise your hand, Billy. He oversees El Centro Chicano, one of our primary partners at DPS. Letty, she's the one who actually keeps Billy in line and gets things done. So I always go to Letty. Letty's here, so thank you for coming. Rosalind Curry oversees the Center for Black Cultural Student Affairs, another partner. And I just want to say to my other great friend, Varun Soni. Varun and I, again, another partner who helps this university, helps our students, helps this community in ways that just we wouldn't be what we are without him. So Varun, thank you for even considering me for this. I really appreciate and thank you for it. As we always say to each other, one love. So that, and another dear friend, Kathy Williams from LAPD. She works community relations. Kathy, right there. She's another person that through my career at LAPD was steadfast in commitment to community relations and building partnerships. And again, Ryan. Ryan, as a 14-year-old kid, Ryan literally lives a couple of blocks, grew up two blocks from here, like myself. He's a native of South LA. Joined our cadet post. Our cadet post has some of the most amazing young people from South LA that you know, joined our post with the expectations of, you know, possibly thinking about law enforcement, but I could care less about them becoming law enforcement officers. I'm more concerned about them being good citizens, good people, but also understanding that a college education is an attainable goal and something that they should seek, and we give them the support to do that. And I'm so blessed that we are now, we've probably got three young people from this neighborhood that are actually USC students that are a part of our post. And I wouldn't say that it was only because of the post, but I think, and one of the things I'm going to talk about is what is the purpose of great universities like USC in communities like South LA? Because the reality is, if I didn't live in close proximity to USC, I probably would not have thought much about obtaining a college education. Many of my peers, they were much smarter than I am or was. But the reality is, they didn't have influences and they didn't have people that reached out to them, or they didn't live in proximity to USC where the resources were available from USC that would reach out to someone like me. A little bit about me and, you know, what matters to me and why. First and foremost, let me say, you know, my faith and my family, but I'm quite sure you don't want to hear about that. You kind of want to hear about, you know, my values and how I lead the Department of Public Safety. And, you know, I will give you a little bit of background of me. I grew up in South LA, lived all over the place. My formative years and pretty much my years as a college student, I commuted. I actually lived closer to USC, so I actually commuted from South LA to Westwood. which is a challenge in and of itself if you're African American and you had a wreck of a car like mine that you couldn't drive on the freeway, so I had to drive down Wilshire Boulevard. And I tell people the stories all the time. It wasn't a matter of if I was gonna get stopped by LAPD or Beverly Hills PD or Culver City PD. It was a matter of when. And you know, trust me, growing up in an environment and trying to get an education, and your biggest concern was not your examinations, but whether or not you would have an encounter with the police that would be, you know, one, demoralizing at times, or whether or not you possibly could have made that quote-unquote furtive movement, and that would have been the end of you. So those were realities for me, just as I was commuting from school. But the environment growing up in South LA was one where, you know, as Ryan mentioned, if you grew up in South LA or East LA, your relationships are probably not going to be very positive when it comes to interaction with the police. Now, I'm not going to bash the police, because I think the police, we do an incredible job, incredible, difficult job, and 99.5% of the officers in this profession want to make a difference and they want to do the right things. But the reality is, we're at a point in this profession where it's a wake-up call. The communities across America have determined and decided the direction that we shall go. And that direction is that they want to be policed constitutionally, and they want relationships with the officers that serve their community. And they want the departments that serve them to be reflective of the people that live in those communities. So that's what's important to me. If I had to summarize what that would mean, I would probably say that ensuring trust and legitimacy while establishing strong community partnerships. And I want to talk about it in the context of USC campus community, because I'm most familiar with this community from several perspectives. Perspective of an individual who grew up in this community, and I know what USC means to this community. My grandparents moved to this community in the 1940s, one of the first African-American families to live around here, and white flight over the course of the time that they lived here, it became an African-American community. But there was a great sense of pride in living close to USC. You know, my grandparents walked around the tracks, and it was a place where the services that and the outreach for the community, USC always made the members of this community feel welcome. As a young person, I went to Crenshaw High School. If you know anything about the high schools or the schools in South LA or East LA, very poor performing. I can't even imagine what it must be like now. I went there from 77 to 1980. Most of the books that I was required to have for AP English and history and the AP classes I had, didn't even have them. So how do you take and be successful academically when your library does not have the books that are required for AP classes? That's where USC came in. I had a library card at Doheny Library throughout high school. So I spent a lot of time here at USC studying here at Doheny Library because I had a library card there. And that opened my eyes to the reality that a college education was something attainable for me, because you got to understand South LA. You could live 3 miles to the south, to the west, to the east, and literally never know or set foot on this campus. That's a reality. We brought a group of kids from Watts to USC, and they thought USC was a football team. So the realities of this great institution in a place like South LA, we often take it for granted, but it has great significance to the people that live in close proximity. For me, had I not lived in close proximity to USC, I would have probably been like a lot of my buddies. They were the victims of, they fell prey to survival. And survival for them often meant I'm going to enhance my ability to get money by any means necessary. And oftentimes, that meant illegal activities. Me, I was a little scared of gangs. I knew a lot of gang members and people like that. How do you not? If you grew up in South LA during my time, there's no way. You know, and that caused me some problems when in 1984, after UCLA, I decided that I was going to seek a career with the Los Angeles Police Department. I probably should not, if things had worked the way the system was designed for LAPD then, and Kathy can tell you, there were people that made it very difficult for people like myself that grew up in South LA or East LA or marginalized communities to come on LAPD. The biggest concern that they had wasn't that I was a student at UCLA and that I never had a criminal history or anything like that. The biggest issue for me doing backgrounds was, how do you know this gang member, that gang member, this gang member, and you're related to these gang members? How do you sit in front of us and you tell us that you have no gang affiliations? Well, my answer was pretty simple. Did you, Mr. Background Investigator, have a choice of where you were going to be raised and grew up? No, neither did I. So the reality for me, this is where I lived. This is where I grew up. This is what I knew. I didn't choose that environment, but that was the biggest hang up for me coming on LAPD. And I remember literally sitting on the steps of City Hall crying because I felt like this is so unfair. I've never committed a crime. I've never been in any trouble. I'm a student at UCLA. I'm doing everything right. And the only concern that they have is, how can I know these individuals and not have gotten caught up, and how can I tell them that I was not affiliated with gang activities? Well, I knew them. They grew up with me. They grew up in my neighborhood. They were related to me, but I never committed a crime. But I was judged by the fact that I knew these people. And it was only, and this is where, you know, life has, it takes turns that, you know, you just got to be prepared for where it takes you. I remember meeting, and I would later work for him as chief of police, Bernard Parks. But at one point, Bernard Parks was in charge of personnel. And somebody says, well, you know, this is pretty common at LAPD. Why don't you give him a call? I'm like, I can't call him. I don't know him. So I called Bernard Parks up, and I basically tell him what happened. And he just listened, and he says, young man, I will call you back. He says, call me when you get a call back from your background investigator. I had no idea what to expect. So I told him the story. He said absolutely nothing. And if you know Bernard Parks, he doesn't say a lot, but he listens intuitively, and he has gone through some things himself as an African-American, rising through the ranks of the police department to become eventually chief and growing up in South LA. I get a call back from my background investigator probably 2-3 hours later, and in a very rude and condescending tone, he says, you're going into the 1184 Police Academy class. And I said, I thought you said you lost my package. I thought you had questions about, and he said, do you want to go to LAPD Academy? Because if you don't, I will find somebody else. I said, yes, sir, I will. And I went into the LA Police Academy, and it was an eye-opening experience. And as I said, I had a great career. I think I did a lot of great work, and I worked with some amazing officers. But what I found that was probably most troubling about that period of LAPD, and it's not the LAPD today. LAPD, like any other major entity, law enforcement entity in America, is going through growing pains. But I can say that the Los Angeles Police Department is conscientiously trying to be a more transparent and much more constitutionally driven department, and one that is working creatively with many components of the community, the diverse communities throughout LA, the city of LA. So the challenges then in the early 80s was this mentality in law enforcement and the way we were trained. And in essence, what the solution, I think, to all of this is, how are departments recruiting and how are they training and how they are deploying the officers in a manner consistent with the values of those communities. When I look back on 1984, when I began law enforcement, women at LAPD were just probably with, had only been allowed to work 4 years in patrol. LAPD was one of the last vestiges where it believed that women should and could work patrol. Matter of fact, I will quote then Chief Davis when he was asked at a press conference why there were no women working patrol in LAPD. He says, well, I will put a woman in patrol at LAPD when the Rams, who were then here in LA, when the Rams will put a woman in as quarterback. So you pretty much, that was the mentality that you were dealing with. And you had also just probably within the last 15 years where African Americans could work together as partners. Now, the dichotomy of all that is LAPD hired the first woman in law enforcement in 1913 or so. It hired the first African American male in law enforcement in 1886, I believe. So it had a long history of being progressive in those ways. But though that progress was as a result of some inherent prejudices. African Americans were recruited to LAPD because you had a growing African American population along Central Avenue. White officers didn't want to work the black community. So by necessity, LAPD began to hire. So you had a history that evolved up until the point where I came on LAPD, where it was just kind of coming out of the dark ages, you know, 1984. And I, you know, find myself again, it seems like for whatever reason, most of my career, I could not get out of South LA, which, you know, I had no problem. I loved it. But I also encountered having to work with people that I felt like they just don't get this community. They just aren't even trying. They would say some of the most disrespectful and rude, and I don't think they were doing it purposely. Just like with my experience when I went to UCLA and I had never, ever, ever sat in a classroom with a white student. Majority of time from K through 12, African American and Latino. That's all I knew. So I go to UCLA. So I understood the mentality of some of these, the officers when they said some of those things. I don't think they said it with the full knowledge of how disrespectful and disparaging they were. Just as when I was at UCLA and I'd hear students say, my peers at UCLA say, well, I would have gone to USC, but it's in a bad neighborhood. And I'm thinking, well, it's my neighborhood. It's my neighborhood, you know? And those kinds of comments, where people make those kinds of off-color comments where I don't think they really understand that those are neighborhoods that are comprised of good, hardworking people. And I'm going to jump over into another area. And I also have to fight this misconception with our students and others that the belief that the people in this community are the ones that commit crimes against our students and against the university. It's not the case. Like any American university, you have a cottage industry of individuals that prey on college campuses because primarily it's an easy place to commit crimes. Students don't lock their doors. Students leave their property in plain sight, and it's a very lucrative environment. But the members of this community do not, they're not the ones responsible for the crimes against USC. They never have been. There's a great sense of pride. And when I think back to being deployed in the 1992 riots and living in this community, which was a very heartbreaking time for me, not a single building at USC was damaged, vandalized. There was not even an encroachment on USC because it has such a great affinity from the community. Community loves USC. It's just has that kind of status. Now everything around USC burned to the ground. What you see over at Vermont and 37th, where Taco Bell and Smart and Fun, that burned to the ground. Everything there is different. I know that because my grandmother's favorite Chinese restaurant was there, and she cried for days that her friend lost her restaurant, and where am I going to get my Chinese food now? So those are things that when you look at and you think about this community and you think about what USC means to it and the opportunities that I think that the untapped possibilities for USC to do great things in the community surrounding both this campus and the campus in East East LA. It's just untapped potential. And I tell our students all the time, there's no greater legacy that you can leave for USC than to get involved in the neighborhoods around where you live, because USC is no longer a commuter campus. When I was studying here, most of the students that went to USC, they commuted. It's now a residential campus. The majority of the students that go to USC now, they live in the surrounding neighborhoods. They're part of the neighborhood. But when I ask students, do you know your non-USC affiliated neighbors? No. But then when I talk to our community members, and I go to a lot of community meetings, we've established neighborhood watch and block clubs at DPS in the community. They have nothing. Our community members tell us, oh, we look after the USC students all the time. We know that they, you know, they can get loud. And I mean, there's, and we have some people in the community that just, they don't want parties, they don't want this, they don't want that. You're going to have that. But by and large, the majority of these people that live around USC, they are watching our students in ways that you guys don't even imagine, because I hear it all the time, you know. And they see you guys come and go every 4 years or every year more come, and you know, it's, but I do, my challenge to the USC campus community has pretty much been consistent. As a member who once lived in this community, the reality is we miss so many opportunities to impact the quality of life of the people that are good, hardworking people that want the same thing that you want in your communities, wherever you came from in America or in the world. But I think that great institutions have a challenge. And I think USC does a great job. But I think, by and large, the next evolution, and I will be challenging in the months to come, is for our students to roll up their sleeves and get involved. Mentor a kid. Register to vote while you're here for 4 years. There are a whole host of ways that you can have an impact on this community. I was so encouraged by Ryan's involvement in Bernie Sanders' campaign, I had to actually say, you know, you should be studying a little bit. Bernie Sanders is going to be all right. You should be studying. I remember I was in Washington, D.C., and I get a call from this kid, and he's like, Chief, I'm in Washington, D.C. Ironically, I just happened to be there. I need to get to Philadelphia. What's in Philadelphia? Well, I got to go to the convention. Which convention? As if I didn't know. And how do I get to D.C. from Philadelphia? And I'm like, okay, here's the train, Union Station. It'll take you there. Get there, Ryan. Are you studying? Are you taking your books? But the reality is, I'm so pleased that he has gotten involved in not just his major, which is chemistry, nanoscience, which I have no idea what that means. But the reality is, I am so encouraged by the fact that he has become passionate about what's going on in this community and what's going on in our nation. And you know, the other thing is, you know, as I talk to our students, and I digress into some politics, there's some great concerns that our students have, particularly our students from other countries. And I hear it every single meeting I have with students from other countries. Chief, what's going on with the immigration piece? You know, what is DPS's posture? What is LAPD's posture when it comes to immigration status and all those things? Well, the reality is, you know, that's something that as you pursue your education and you're from another country, you shouldn't be thinking about that. And our posture at DPS is immigration status and the status of a student studying here or anyone in the community, that's not something that we're going to ask. That's not something we're going to enforce. That's not something we're concerned about. Despite what's going on in that's coming out of the White House. And I am troubled when I have to explain something like that to our students, and not only the students that are here that are graduating and saying, well, now I'm having a hard time finding internships because people are, companies are saying, well, you know, you only have a year to be here. Why would I invest in you when you probably not going to give me what I need? So it's impacting ways other than just while people are here studying. There's a long-term effect. But I want to assure people that DPS is not, that's not something we're concerned with. And Special Order 40 from LAPD that dates back to 1979 makes it very much against department policy for an LAPD officer to engage in or ask about the immigration status of any individual in the community. You know, but as I kind of come to somewhat of a closure, as I've rambled all over the place, hopefully I made some sense, but the reality is we are at a very unique time in law enforcement where I don't see it as challenges or obstacles. I just think it is opportunities. We have opportunities now to be more responsive in how we police communities, in how we interact, how we engage with communities. Because again, you know, for 200 years, American law enforcement has operated under the same principle of enforcement first. Well, enforcement first has only resulted in what I would term a prison industrial complex. Over my course of career, I've put a lot of people in jail, and unfortunately and sadly, a lot of them looked like me, and a lot of them were either African American or Latino. And you have to ask yourself, did these individuals as children want to be criminals? Because I can tell you they didn't. When I think of the guys in my neighborhood that went on to have prolific drug careers where at the dead end was either death or long-term incarceration, and I told you that were much smarter than me, they didn't want to go that path. They wanted to be doctors, they wanted to be lawyers, they wanted to be firemen, they wanted to be policemen, they wanted to go to college, they wanted to go to USC. But that's like, you know, finding the proverbial needle in a haystack for them. Where, how, who? There's just no avenues by which they could obtain those dreams. So what did they do? They turned to what was there. And what was there were drug dealers, pimps, murderers, you know, career criminals. But that wasn't what they wanted to be. That's not what they wanted to do. And sadly, you know, you got to ask the question also, who profits by these long-term incarcerations? That's not the answer. And I got to ask myself, why is it that, you know, when they go to prison, they can trade their labor for 8 cents an hour and 11 cents an hour? And you got to ask yourself, who profits off of that? It's certainly not the individuals that we're quote unquote trying to rehabilitate. So the reality is, these are some tough questions. The answers are equally tough. But I tell you this, you know, I'm optimistic because as we do the work at DPS of looking at how do we engage the communities around USC, how do we get the students to engage the communities around USC, I want to think that we're providing a model for what policing should look like in the 21st century. One of the quotes that President Obama stated when he launched the initiative, which turned into the President's Task Force on 21st Century Policing in 2015. And if you haven't read that document, please download it. It's awesome. That is the blueprint for where policing in America needs to go. But he said, when any part of the American family does not feel like it's being treated fairly, that's a problem for all of us. And as the most visible representatives of government, law enforcement, and the one that probably the most disenfranchised people in our communities will come in contact with, we have an obligation to get this right. We have an obligation to do what is constitutionally correct and what is humanely correct. So our role is pretty significant, and I'm very excited about the prospect of working collaboratively with communities and increasing the level of engagement, because we're not going to solve these problems of homelessness, mental illness, which by in and of themselves, these are not police problems, but my officers have to deal with these by default because there's nothing in place for them not to. And they're not equipped. They're not really equipped. But just by default, they have to, when that call comes, you can't say, you know, your brother's mental illness issue because he didn't take his medicine is not our problem. We got to go. And sometimes there's tragic consequences that we did not intend. But, you know, the reality is we're not trained, and it's not right for us to have to bear the burden of dealing with some of these societal issues. So I'm optimistic when it comes to what are the realities that the future holds for us to potentially work collaboratively with the community to engage and better the communities for everyone. And I think that's what the charge is. And the charge is that we're not going to solve these police community issues with body cameras, civilian oversight, all those things. Because the cops are human. You're going to have cops that are good. You're going to have cops that are bad. Some of my officers have good days. Some of them have horrible days. When they have horrible days, if I find out it, you go home. Because we can ill afford to be that department that is national news as a result of, you know, your cynicism, your implicit or explicit biases. And those are things that as leaders of law enforcement agencies like myself and other progressive chiefs, we have to be about guarding against those propensities that are inevitable if you don't weed them out. Because over the course of a 20-year career or a 10-year career or a 5-year career, the amount of cynicism that an officer can develop if you're not working to weed that stuff out, it can be devastating. And oftentimes it can go undetected. But we have to be guards of that. And we have to have accountability measures that are based upon what are the community standards and what are the community norms. So I'm very ecstatic about the direction that law enforcement is going, and take away the names of these controversial uses of force and murders of African American and Latino men, and I just see opportunities. I think that in the long term, the relationships that we have to develop are better. Right now, police departments they're getting exactly what they're recruiting. If you recruit and you appeal to an individual's sense of adventure and excitement and adrenaline, which a lot of police departments do, that's what you're going to get. But if you appeal to the realities of police work, which is service and interpersonal interactions and the ability to work collectively with a whole wide range of people, then you'll get the department that is reflective and compassionate and understanding of what the community expectations are. I think I'm getting the... Okay. Anyone have any questions for me? And thank you for being so attentive again. Thank you. Any questions? Thank you. Thank you. Anyone with any question? Why did I choose policing? That's a great question. I wanted to make a difference, and I actually wanted to model what was not my reality in dealing with the police. Any other questions? That was a good one, whoever asked that one. Yes, ma'am.
Can you tell us a little about your parents?
I was raised by a single mom. My mom raised 6 kids. My dad left when I was about 7. I knew who he was, but my dad, when he came back from Vietnam, he did not come back the same man. So he had a history after that of drug and alcohol. He was not capable of caring for me and my 5 brothers and sisters. So, but my mom was very, very scary. I had a bigger fear of my mom than any police officer could have ever invoked on me. So yeah, I'm the product of a single parent family, and I was raised on welfare. Billy? Oh, okay, thank you.
All right, thank you, Chief Thomas. For those of you who need to go, it is 12:50 in case you guys need to go, but just if you have any more questions for the chief, he'll be around for a few more minutes. Thank you so much, Chief, for speaking to the students. And one quick thing, on behalf of the students here at the University of Southern California, for all your work, we'd like to present you with this journal so that you may continue to...
I need it.
So that you may continue to write down and express your thoughts, and hopefully those thoughts become actions for future leadership in law enforcement and that this community needs to thrive and prosper. So thank you so much for everything that you do. It's greatly appreciated. And thank you to everyone for showing up. Have a wonderful day, and as we say at USC, fight on.